me that you like it, yeah.
And welcome back to yet another edition of Tell Me Something Good. It is Masters Week. So during Masters Week, you talk golf, you talk women in golf. And if I'm talking women in golf, there is nobody better than my friend Elisa Gaudet. We were just figuring it out. We know each other for like 25 years. It's crazy.
Craziness.
Welcome to my show. Welcome to my audience. Tell me something good.
Thank you, Steve. Yes, I know. We both still have 21, right? something good. Tiger's playing in the Masters. What better news? I mean, the only thing better than that is Tom Brady back with the Buccaneers. I mean, it's like Christmas, big time.
What is
Santa's coming for Christmas with both of those. But yeah, Tiger's the big news. Brutal accident. I don't think anybody, you know, thought he would ever play this soon, but in total Tiger fashion, you can, one, never count him out, and two, what a great platform to come back, you know, like it's going to go big or go home.
So for my audience that doesn't know you, talk me through how long you've been in golf. You've done so many great things. Back when I used to live in Broward County, you were doing stuff all over the place. So give our audience a sense of how much golf means to you and what you've done to golf.
Yeah, definitely. So I've been on the business side for, like we were saying, 20 some odd years. And I started working out of Miami for the Tour de las Americas, the Latin golf tours, like PGA Tour of Latin America. And I worked for them for a little while. And I'll never forget, I was down in Argentina in 2000 for the World Cup, the Golf World Cup. And there was a big run because it was Tiger Woods and David Duval were like neck and neck with Cabrera and Romero on the last day, which was like unheard of that you could have, like, you couldn't have staged it better. Netflix couldn't have done a better job. Two Argentines neck and neck with the greatest players from the U.S. And they, you know, Tiger won, but there I met some people from the PGA Tour and I ended up getting a job and working for the PGA Tour and running the World Cup 2 years later, the exact same event 2 years later in Mexico. And I lived in Mexico for 14 months to execute that event. I call it my NBA. I got schooled 8 ways to Sunday. International business, sports business, sponsorship, tablecloths, hotel arrangements, you name it. So, and then after that, as you mentioned, we were both living in Miami at that time, and I started a company, Executive Golf International, in 2003. That's a strategic marketing and branding. I just saw a lot of companies really could probably use some assistance navigating golf because it's not the same as other sports where it's just TV rights and merchandising. Pretty straightforward for NBA, NFL, MLB. It's, you know, people don't buy houses next to a football stadium or go on football stadium vacations. So, yeah, to give you an idea, you know, golf has a lot more, whether it's home purchases or golf vacations, memberships, a lot of things that I think add to what makes up the golf industry, which generates more in revenue than the motion picture industry. People don't realize that. So
people don't realize that.
And then here I am, 20, then that is 20, wrote 3 books and then all different about people, athletes that all love golf, you know, celebrities that love golf, titans of business, you know. So it's a lot of industry leaders, how they end up owning a golf course, they'd own it outright. So Herb Kohler or, Reebok. Why am I forgetting his name? Built Liberty National. But it's going to be bad. A number of people that, like, it's almost like a vanity project or what have you, but they did build, like, someone builds a museum, they built golf courses. So, and then in 2016, I started this was a little side gig called Women's Golf Day, a way to get more women on the golf course. And we have these events and they can be public or private. And the location can charge a fee or not, but it's the first Tuesday in June every year. And, you know, locations sign up, they register with us, and then women can go anywhere in the world. And last year was our 6th year. And despite the pandemic, we had 880 locations in 68 countries all on the same day.
So the numbers play golf grew, which was an anomaly, it hadn't happened before, but specifically women who play golf in 2021, the numbers are staggering. So
yes.
600. What is the number?
450,000 women took up golf. 500,000, effectively, in the United States during the pandemic.
Which,
and now our job is, how do we keep them? Like, so we as an industry, how do we keep them?
Unpack that for me, if you would, and say, and like, why? What was the fascination that all of a sudden women came running to this sport where they hadn't done it before?
Right. I don't know the numbers on juniors, but let's just start with, there weren't too many things you could do. We're not competing. We've talked about this in the sports industry, especially Miami used to struggle with, how do you get people to a heat game? You know, there's, people have so many options. Well, this was the only option. It's outdoors. We're still allowed to do it. I think the rules became very relaxed. Like, you know, we're not going to put the pin flag, you know, you don't have to take the pin flag out. And, you know, probably somebody starting doesn't know. It was a lot more relaxed. I think that helped. It's the only thing you could do. People wanted to be outside. And I think they thought, you know, I've got nothing to lose. And hopefully, you know, they went around, or people were offering to, like, you know, have them take a class or do something that felt that was not intimidating. And let's not negate, I think that Topgolf has done a lot for the industry. I don't know if there's a way that we can, they know how many people come through their doors, that conversion rate, or that somebody goes there, tries it. I was like, you know what, maybe I do want to try getting out on the golf course. This is kind of fun, you know?
So I think the fact that it became less intimidating when they dropped some of the rules, even for a guy like me, who I'm not an avid golfer. I play tournaments. I play occasionally. I play okay. But there's so many things that happen on a golf course that were so much fun. You're right. Outdoors. There is the benefit of walking a golf course. You do burn calories. You do, you know, like, I do a good job of putting those calories back in with one of the sponsors, like Heineken or something like that.
Exactly.
But for women, so it solves a couple of issues. And then I guess from a business perspective, they get to take advantage of the things that men have known for a long time, that if you get a decision maker out there for a couple hours, good things happen.
And I tell people all the time, especially women, like, don't think that, you know, people always say, oh, they do business on the golf course. People are going to the golf course with a contract rolled up in their golf bag. It's just that you created a relationship during those 4 hours, and uninterrupted. If you went to a restaurant, or you went to some other sporting event, or you were sitting in somebody's offices, there's going to be a lot of interruption. There's going to be a secretary, phones ringing. There's going to be other people. That's the thing, that you have a captive audience, and you're talking about, hey, what are your kids doing? And what are you doing for the summer? And you're going to see how the person is, and, you know, you create a bond. And it's, you know, at the end of the day, it still goes back to relationships, you know, relationships that drive our industry, drive a lot of industries. And we're seeing it more too, that people are also putting their money where their allegiance and alliance, and that have common values. And that, you know, is kind of, like you said, what a lot of us knew before, but it's not like a secret contract in the bag, you know?
This is you're coming to us live from Augusta, where it all happens. So talk to me specifically about women at Augusta. I know this year there was actually a tournament there, a women's tournament that happened last week. Am I correct?
Exactly. The ANWA. Yeah. Augusta National Women's Amateur. And it's something they just started in the last, I don't know if this is a second or third iteration. I should know that. And trust me, I'm like, they sent me, I guess a couple of people, I'm not really sure who or how it got happened, but they sent me a magnolia tree to my house in, you know, appreciation of, you know, what we're doing, because we are amateur golf around the world. But this is such a wonderful thing, because for so long, you know, they had a bad rap of not having female members, which they do, of course. They have Condoleezza Rice and a number. That's up to them. They're a private club. I mean, yes, they should have female members, but how many or who or whatever, that's their choice. But I think it was a very smart move, and very much in the essence of Bobby Jones and the amateur, of what so much Augusta is still about, and that they haven't sold out on a lot of things with regard to really making it a giant sponsor fest or what have you. For them to host those young women is, I think, so incredible and so smart and so encouraging on the highest level platform, does so much for our game, for women, whether you like golf or not. Like, wow, holy cow, these No, it's like seeing girls in the WNBA or whatever, you know, it's like you got to have appreciation for what it takes. I don't care if you're in business, if you're a mom, if you run a company, if you're a professional athlete, anybody knows what it takes to put the work in to get the results. And it doesn't happen by zero effort.
One of the things we talked about on this show as fellow entrepreneurs, you know, there are keys to success. So you've been doing this 20 plus years. You're successful. You're well known. When they reached out and said you wanted to be on the show, I was thrilled. I couldn't wait to see you. So, two-part question. What makes you you? What have you learned over the years that are the keys to success? And then I absolutely want you to comment on being at Augusta when Tiger's playing. What's going on there? How's it going? What do you expect? So first part, what are the keys to success? What would you, you know, tell your younger self or somebody who's coming up the ranks? What do you need to be good at in order to be, do what you do?
Yeah, you know, this is where, like, God bless Gary Vee. I wish he was around when I was 20. Yeah. I love that guy. Yeah, not worry about the opinions of other people. I mean, I think my industry is very conservative and very, you know, it's this one way. And I used to run around with my little, like, you know, blue shirt and beige suit. And, you know, and that isn't what we've all learned now as we get older. Not just that, like what business has learned, what industries have learned, like cell phones, people want a purple one or a pink one or a white one or a black one. Is like what makes us able to do amazing things is bringing your uniqueness to it, not bringing the same old. So I finally I think when I let go of the business part and it went to that book writing, I was like, it was a whole different, like, that's a whole different thing. I'm like selling books. I'm out. I'm doing that whole thing. Editorial side, it gave me the freedom to be me, more me. And then now with Women's Golf Day, yeah, it's just like, hey, this is what we're doing. This is my little fingerprint. When I leave the world, this is what I did. And I'm in that lane and that's my lane. And if you're a brand, the train's already left the station. We're in year 7. You're either on the train or you're not. And with everything that's going on with empowering women and what have you, this is how I feel. And I think that people should find their, not to sound esoteric, but their inner truth. What do you want to do? What lights you up in the morning? And there's going to be some shitty times. And there's going to be, could be, you know, financial up and downs. There could be, you know, nothing comes easy. That's the thing, I think. I think a younger generation, I hope that they're not like getting caught up in this whole like, hey, I'm just going to throw a few selfies up there and I'm going to be... Every one of those, Gary Vee, you, I, we have put the time in. You didn't, like, you know, before I got on, I'm sure all of your audience knows, but, you know, God bless you for, I remember you starting this podcast and now, yeah, your success has come because you continued with it, because you keep going, you get interesting, creative people. People want to hear content.
You're on your content. First of all, flattered, but you're correct. So I do have a question about the Women's Day. So diversity is a hot topic with every CEO that I am talking to. They are all focused on diversity as a change agent, you know, and a lot of the legal and accounting, you know, those are categories that are traditionally old white guys, you know. It's like,
yeah,
and let's mix it up. So a lot of the events that are happening for women, they are inviting men to come. Do men play on Women's Day, or is it just?
They can. We don't, you know, we are, you know, we have our like legal disclaimer, but of course we don't like turn anybody away, no matter gender, sex, religion, race. However, when, you know, I didn't like wake up one morning and go, I think I'll have an event on the first Tuesday in June. That sounds cool. I kept reading these studies, you know, because people do, like, you wonder, like, you really think I just like woke up, emailed everybody, and they all just said, yeah, let's do an event on the first Tuesday in June every year. I asked a lot of multi-course owners, like the Troons of the world and other club corps, which are all private courses, and PGA Tour Superstore, you know, the chief marketing officer. Hey, I have this idea based on the data. So I took all the data. It said women thought it was too slow, it was too long, it was intimidating, it wasn't for them. It goes on and on. Took every single one, like, okay, short format, 4 hours. First 2 hours are golf. The interesting part is if you've never touched a golf club before, you come for the first 2 hours and you would take lessons. An hour on the driving range, an hour chipping and putting. If you already play golf, you go play nine holes. And the second 2 hours is socializing. And that's how women engage with one another more. And they're going to compare notes, say, hey, why don't you just hop on the cart with me next time I go? Or, you know, oh, you've played, but you haven't played in a while. Just jump into the, as a sub on the league. Or there's a lot of ways it made it very easy for them. We tried to. And listen, you and I and four other people on here show up at tennis lessons and we don't know each other. No one's like, let's go to Wimbledon. Because most things you ever do, we're with a bunch of other new people and we all don't know what the hell we're doing. But it's knitting classes to tennis to, like, you know, you have to see these campaigns. Let's do golf. Like, let's do jiu-jitsu. You're going to run out. You don't even know what jiu-jitsu is. So it's the same. We can't think in the industry that people know what it is. And it was just to, like, try to create a comfort level. It's very relaxed. Just, we tell everybody to wear red and white, but unless the club has strict regulations, then, you know, that you feel like I don't have to have all this gear to go show up. And all the Top Golf locations do it. All the PGA Tour Superstore locations do it. PGA Tour Superstore is free. So if you're intimidated, you just have to, hey, women, we're good at walking into stores. Walk in the store. If you don't like it, you can walk back out. But, like, you don't have to show up at a golf course. What do I wear? There's a very, and then from there, you're going to figure out, oh, okay. And next time or on your own fruition, we really are trying to position ourselves as a resource and a feeder. So you'll see there's a lot of resources on our thing. Like, then how do you get a handicap? Or what are the rules of golf? One-stop junior programs. You know, more and more we keep adding that. And hopefully it's a funnel. We're not turning this into learn to golf the Women's Golf Day way. There's so many pros out there that are so qualified, male and female. We want to direct them to, like, get lessons, get people into it. We're like a giant funnel, feeder.
Your enthusiasm and energy is reminiscent of what people say about me. That's what they wind up buying. So you're on this amazing crusade, and good for you, because I'm engaged. I can't wait to see it. And anything I can do to be part of it, switch gears and talk to me about being at Augusta right now. And knowing that Tiger's going to play, I made a comment to my son the other day. I had just seen a picture of Tiger, and I said, he looks incredible. And then
I know, right?
I hear the stories 14 months ago, that guy almost lost his leg, man. He's
crushed.
The coming back of Tiger again and again. So what's the mood in Augusta?
Don't you feel like it's like some kind of, like, mythical or like Shakespearean? It's truly unbelievable. So I am not, it's been raining. I don't know if people who are really following it. Like, yesterday was downpouring. I'm not on the course today. I don't know if we have a big industry event this evening. I don't know if he'll be there. It's our golf writers and everybody who's in the that side of golf. So usually a lot of them are there as well. But it is already electric. You can feel it. I've been here, you know, there was a time early in my career, which I, you know, don't want to be braggalicious, but I went 13 years in a row to the Masters. So it's kind of like, I don't really want to walk around a slotchy golf course, you know? But whenever he is there, it is insane. The energy, like, you can feel it. And you can be on one side. And this is the thing where they don't have a lot of, there's no hospitality on that. I mean, you'll see some stands where people can sit, but there's no hospitality tents. It's meant to be really natural. And you can be on one side of that course, and as big as it is, and you'll hear this roar, you know, that's where Tiger is. There could be, you know, a couple other, everybody who's there is super famous, but they can be, like, you know, walking along with zero gallery, crickets going off because people are just around Tiger. And I think also, you know, Phil's not here this year, so.
So I think from business perspective, Tiger's been the best thing that ever happened to golf besides you.
No, he's much better than he has. And nobody should in our industry should ever negate. We all have benefited, including myself, because of Tiger Woods, every single one of us.
So the,
he has, yeah. And I think the number one thing, which I'm interested to see too, Nielsen ratings. Love that. What is it going to look like when we turn around? What's going to be, you know, I hope, I mean, listen, number one, that's who I'd love to see win this. Because we're especially Americans, we love these comeback stories, you know?
Now, the stories I hear, and I don't know this for fact, is that his girlfriend is very engaged in the game also. She follows him around and she's very into it, which can only bode well for you, because the more women faces that you can get, the more I'm sure engagement you'll get from the female audience.
Yeah, I think anybody that's in a high profile, we're actually doing a campaign right now called A to Z, Women Golf Daily. So it's kind of using our same acronym, WGD, because it's not just one day, but we're highlighting women, celebrities, as well as professional, like Annika. You know, we started with Anwa, the girl who won was Anna Davis, this amateur. So ironically, it was a great way for us to kick it off. But, Amanda Baliones, sports reporter, she's out here this week. But, you know, and there's a lot of people. And then on the other side, the companies, you know, Callaway. Yeah, they sponsor us, but I'm going to, like, they spent the money to do the R&D and came up with, so one of the first, I think, companies that's ever done it, like really put the R&D to come up with clubs. They're called the Reba, that are just designed for women. So I'm like, now we're cooking with oil. A couple of these companies that are really thinking, like, and my number one line everywhere I speak, every time I say, is Apple only selling to 50% of the population? Is Nike only selling to 50%? Why is golf only selling? Let's cut all the, yes, of course, we want diversity, equity, and inclusion, but let's just talk straight business. Do you only sell to, do you only have male people listening to your podcast?
No, as a matter of fact, the majority of my client base is female CEOs. I'm not really sure why. There's no specific formula there, but I am so blessed to be around great women. And the perspective that I get from them is almost equal to what I give them, you know? So it's this magical, you know, learning thing that's happening, which is why our business has exploded. So I'm blessed. I'm thrilled that you came to share your story and your day. Whatever I can do to help you, whoever I know, you know, I'm just so glad we got back together. And have fun. And I'll be rooting for Tiger as well.
Yes. And that is right back at you. However I can help you. I love what you're doing. I think it's phenomenal. And I am more than happy. I'm on the train. I'm on the Steve train, and I'm on the, yeah, tell me something good.
When you're back in town, let's grab some lunch so you can tell me all the stories.
Yes, I will. For sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Tell me something.